This is Rob Gray from ASU and PerceptionAction.com. Today on the Perception in Action podcast, my interview with Amit Katwala, senior writer for Sport Magazine and author of the new book, The Athletic Brain, how neuroscience is revolutionizing sport and can help you perform better. Hi, everyone. Welcome to the Perception in Action podcast, where I discuss how psychological research can be applied to improving performance, accelerating skill acquisition, and designing technologies. In today's episode, my interview with Amit Katwala, author of the book The Athletic Brain. Amit is an award-winning writer for Sport Magazine in the UK, who has interviewed a wide array of sports stars. He received his bachelor's degree in experimental psychology from Oxford University. In the interview, we discuss topics including how the brains of elite athletes are different from normal people, some methods teams are using to shortcut this process with brain training, ways you can trick yourself into having greater endurance, how to better diagnose concussions, the idea of sporting IQ, and examples of sports psychology at work in the recent Olympic Games. Hope you enjoy.
Not 10 years ago, I was a child. I was a good boy and you let me go. Now I'm on a talk show.
So my guest today is Amit Katwala, senior writer for Sport Magazine and author of the new book, The Athletic Brain, How Neuroscience is Revolutionizing Sport and Can Help You Perform Better. Thanks for taking some time to talk with me, Amit.
Thank you for having me.
So to start off, can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you got interested in writing about sports?
I've always loved sports ever since I was a kid. So for the last 5 years, I've been working as a journalist for a sport magazine here in the UK. So I've been interviewing athletes and, you know, speaking to some of the sort of biggest names in football, soccer, and Formula One and tennis and all these other sports. But before that, I studied experimental psychology at university. So I had this kind of academic background in neuroscience and how the brain worked. And a couple of years ago, someone kind of approached me with the idea of doing a book, and it seemed natural to kind of try and merge my two interests into looking at how the brains of these elite athletes kind of worked. And from then came across all these companies and all these new training tools and techniques that people were using to try and help amateurs perform better by training their brain. And it's been really fascinating.
Yeah, no, obviously, you know, you're preaching to the choir for me. I think there's so much going on right now. So you did, what kind of stuff did you do in experimental psychology kind of in general?
So it was very science focused. So it wasn't a lot of psychology degrees, at least here in the UK, kind of still focused on Freud and Jung and that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. But we were very much a science based approach. So we were looking at the physiology of the brain and action potentials and all that, that kind of stuff. And then for my third year project, I did an EEG study of music processing in the brain. So I was trying to find out whether errors in music are treated in a similar way to errors in grammar and language, and looking for a similar effect on EEG.
Okay, that sounds really interesting. Yeah, I'm kind of the same background. I think it's a good preparation for kind of doing the application to get that good, solid experimental training,
I think.
So turning to your book, the first part of the book kind of focuses on how elite athletes' brains are different, you know, how through these hours and hours of practice and training they're kind of different than the average person. And can you tell us a little bit about, you know, maybe a couple examples about how you found sport changes our brains?
I'm sure, as you know, there's two main areas that separates elite athletes from your average person. So the first is anticipation. In baseball or cricket, athletes will pick up advanced cues about the movements of their opponent's bodies earlier than your amateur athlete. And then the second thing is obviously high-speed decision-making. So athletes are able to make the right decision more often and with less time and under higher amounts of pressure. So those are the two things that kind of, I would say, set athletes apart from amateurs. And obviously that comes from thousands of hours of practice, however many thousand you want to say, I'm not sure, but X thousand hours of practice. Yeah,
maybe 10,000.
Maybe 10, maybe not.
still up for debate. So
yeah.
Then kind of the next section, you talk about really how we're starting to try to shortcut this, right? Get these benefits without all those hours. And I think there's two sides of this. There's obviously kind of published research that's starting to come out on that, which, you know, I've talked a bit about, and I know you do as well in the book. And but also, I found it really interesting. You give some good examples of what teams are actually starting to do now, right? Some of the methods they're using. Can you give talk a little bit about that?
Yeah, exactly. This is kind of where I felt I broke new ground a little bit, because obviously a lot of the stuff around anticipation and high-speed decision-making has been written about before, as has the stuff about practice and, you know, outliers and Malcolm Gladwell and all that. So that's kind of covering off the bases and sort of preparing people for the next section of the book, which is, yeah, as you say, about how sports teams are using this knowledge to kind of develop new training tools to help them train their athletes more efficiently. So there's a whole range of stuff that you can use. So there's an American company called Axon Sports who use touchscreen based training tools to train anticipation. Basically what they, you know, you stand in front of a screen and you watch a pitcher throw a baseball towards you, and you have to tap a different button on the screen depending on whether it's whether you think it's a curveball or a slider or a fastball or whatever. And this is relatively simple stuff, but the reason that it helps train your brain is because in an hour you can see hundreds and hundreds of pitches, whereas if you were in a batting cage or out on standard practice, you wouldn't be able to see nearly as many because of, you know, waiting around and going to get the ball when you hit it and this and that. So it's about working out what triggers the brain needs to learn to anticipate, and then finding a way to squeeze as much of that into a shorter amount of time. So that's one quite basic example. But then there are other more innovative ways of kind of making things more efficient. So I went to Hoffenheim, they're a German soccer team, and they've got this device called the Footballnaut, which is a room. It's like 15 feet by 15 feet, a square room, artificial turf, and like ball firing machines on each wall. And you stand in the middle and the machine fires a ball at you, and you have to control it and then pass it through a target gate, which lights up as quickly as you can. And the makers of the machine claim that you can make and receive as many passes in 15 minutes as you would in, you know, a week of normal training. And all that's doing is, you know, using the same neural pathways as you would when you were controlling a pass out on the pitch in real life, but much more efficiently, much more often as well. So that's one of the other techniques.
I think I've seen a video of that that device. So you've talked to a few teams, and I'm sure you know some coaches along the ways. What's kind of your feeling about the general attitude towards these kind of things? Are people pretty open to it, or willing to give it a shot?
I think it really varies, actually. I think some sports are embracing it. Some sports are completely ignoring it. And then I think probably the majority are somewhere in the middle, where they're probably wary. Because, you know, if you are the Red Sox or Manchester United or Real Madrid, you probably get approached by a lot of people claiming that their tool or their technique is going to be the next big thing. So I think a lot of people are probably waiting for research to kind of catch up with the sort of ideas of sort of these thinkers, I guess, because a lot of the tools are kind of a bit up in the air and a bit, well, we're not really sure whether they're working or not. And research is slowly kind of starting to demonstrate that some do, some don't. Here's why they work. Here's why they don't work. I think in 10 years time, when there's more evidence out there for what works and why it works, I think we'll see this catching on in a much bigger way.
Yeah, I agree. I keep harping on about that on this podcast, about the need for, you know, transfer research to show these actually have an effect on the field when you do it later.
Yeah. So there's one study that used, there's a program called NeuroTracker, which is about tracking 3D objects in space. So you put on 3D goggles and you stand in front of a screen, and there's 8 or 10 or 12 little balls kind of bouncing around on the screen. You have to track the position of 4 of them. So they bounce around for 20 seconds, I think it is. And then at the end, you have to pick which 4 you are tracking, point them out on the screen. And there is a study that demonstrates that this kind of training, 3D multiple object tracking training, can actually improve decision making on the pitch. So the research is starting to kind of come, but it's still early days, I think.
Yeah, definitely. Those kind of studies are hard to do. Yeah.
How do you even assess decision making on the pitch?
Yeah.
But actually, one of the things I found really interesting was I went at Hoffenheim, the football club. They've got a test of executive function, a computer-based test of executive function. It kind of looks a bit like a Fisher-Price toy. So there's all these buttons and tones and pedals and stuff, and you have to kind of press buttons in response to tones and press pedals, and there's like a go, no go element as well. It's really hard, actually. I did the test when I went there. It's mentally exhausting. Mm-hmm. I was sweating already, because I'd just been on the football for like 15 minutes. So I was already sweating a bit, but then I did this for 5 minutes and I was sweating even more. But anyway, what they find is that actually they test their players every year, once a year, on this executive function test. And what they find is that as the players train on the pitch, their executive functions off the pitch actually improve.
Okay.
Which is interesting, because what it demonstrates, obviously correlation is not causality, but what it seems to demonstrate is that training on the pitch actually improves your executive functions off the pitch, which is fascinating.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that, whether the teams are actually, that you talk to, are actually trying to relate these tests to stuff that's happening on the field and performance.
Yeah.
That's interesting to hear they are. Yeah.
Yeah, because obviously it is a form of, I don't know what the sort of prevailing attitude towards athletes is in the US, but in the UK it's very much, for footballers especially, it's like people generally think they're pretty stupid. but this is a form of intelligence, right? It's a very highly skilled form of intelligence. They may not be academically trained,
right?
But I guess one of the things I wanted to get across in the book is that their minds are sharp and their minds have been honed for a purpose.
Mm-hmm.
It's just that purpose may not be the same purpose that you as an academic or me as a writer, our minds are probably honed for a different purpose, but that doesn't mean they're not smart.
Yeah, no, I thought you did a really good job emphasizing that. Yeah, there is kind of the same attitude in some sports here. You're right, it's a different kind of intelligence. And speaking of that, in your book, you interviewed some pretty big name athletes. I think you interviewed Wayne Rooney, right? I was wondering, I guess you do that as part of your day job anyway, but I was wondering, what was that like? And what was their kind of attitude towards this brain training idea in sports?
I think a lot of them are kind of willing to try new things. It's kind of hard to get people engaged in that kind of thing. I think generally, maybe as you get older, you kind of become more open to these new ideas, especially if you think they can prolong your career. But a lot of these athletes do these kind of things almost innately. So Wayne Rooney, you mentioned, uses visualization a lot.
Mm-hmm.
And that's not something that anyone's taught him to do. It's something he's always done. Ever since he was a kid, he would imagine himself, scoring great goals or picking the ball up in a particular position on the pitch and running with it or whatever. In a way, visualization is kind of the original brain training tool. So I think a lot of athletes are maybe aware of the fact that it's a mental game. If you ask athletes what's the most important thing about their sport, a lot of them will say, oh, it's mental preparation. So they know.
Mm-hmm.
They know that it's about the brain. And I think what we'll see is that, what we have seen from what I've read about where they've tried to introduce this at a team-wide level in baseball, they've had some sort of, pushback on it. The players haven't necessarily embraced it, but I think if you can demonstrate a clear benefit, then athletes will embrace it the same way they've embraced better nutrition, better sleep. I think this is just the next step in that process.
Yeah, no, I agree. And I think there's a couple good points you make there. I think it's very individual. I think we see the same thing with analytics. I've talked to some people that some athletes, you can give them charts and tons of stats and they're happy to wade through it, where other ones, they want like one point. What's the point you get out of all this? And so I think the brain training is probably going to be the same. Some are open for everything.
Yeah, there's always some resistance from this sort of old guard, isn't there? This classic Moneyball thing, isn't it? It's the traditionalists don't want their, they might sense a threat to their kind of existence if brain training comes in, and they might think it's going to replace whatever training that they're doing or whatever. So there's always a little bit of, some sports are maybe a little bit stuck in their ways in that regard.
Mm-hmm. And then, moving to the final section, you talk about the kind of the next sporting revolution. And so where do you see this all headed? Is it, more research to support it and bigger adoption? Or do you see kind of some different things as well?
I think some of the really interesting stuff and perhaps some of the sort of more ethically dubious stuff, I guess, is things to do with like TMS and TCDS, stimulating the brain, and trying to get improvements that way. So I talk about endurance, for example, and endurance is governed not by muscles, as that we used to think. It's not governed by how much energy is left in your muscles. It's governed by your brain and how much effort your brain thinks that it has exerted, basically.
Mm-hmm. Is that the central governor kind of?
Kind of. It's kind of a step on from that. The central governor says that there is a brake, that the brain has a sort of handbrake, and when you get to a certain limit, it pulls the brake. This is slightly different. This says that it's not about how much effort you've actually exerted. It's about how much effort your brain thinks that it has exerted. So you can trick it. If you can control your perception of effort, you can control your endurance levels. So certain things reduce your perception of effort. So, for example, caffeine reduces your perception of effort, which is why a lot of endurance runners will take caffeine tablets before a race or drink an espresso or chew caffeine gum. Other things are a bit more subtle. So if you get an athlete to run in a hot room, they have atmospheric chambers that they use to kind of prepare athletes for the humidity in somewhere like Rio, for example. But if you actually change the temperature dial without actually changing the temperature, if you mess with the dial but keep the temperature the same, if you tell the athlete it's hotter than it actually is, they will not be able to run as far. Their brain will subconsciously think that it's working harder. So it will kind of put the handbrake on a little bit earlier than it otherwise would, which is really interesting. I don't know if you ever play a video game where you kind of race against your ghost. So you kind of set a best lap time and you kind of have to beat it, and you see the ghost on the track kind of racing around just in front of you or just behind you, depending on how you're doing compared to your previous effort. If you have someone set a personal best and then take a kind of ghost of that, but actually make it faster than their personal best, they'll be able to improve their time because they think they're going at their personal best. They think they're working at their maximum, but they're actually working harder. But because they think they're only working at their maximum, they're able to kind of maintain it, which is really interesting. The brain can be tricked into improving your endurance. And I think that's one of the sort of, to go back to your original question, which you asked me about 20 minutes ago, that's one of the ways where kind of almost an easy win, if you can improve your endurance, that's something that we're going to see a much wider adoption of. And then there are ways of messing with it with brain stimulation and things like that, which might be the kind of thing that gets added to the banned list, you know, alongside steroids and testosterone or whatever.
Yeah, neurodoping, I've heard it called, right?
Yeah, exactly. So yeah. I wrote a piece for The Telegraph here in the UK about neural doping, which is really interesting. There's also some interesting research in rats about reopening critical periods for learning by electrically stimulating parts of the brain with microelectrodes, but I think that's probably some way off, unfortunately.
Yeah, I think that general area is really interesting, but we've kind of leaped, some people have leaped way ahead of what the research has actually shown.
Well, I mean, there's a study in, there's a book called The Brain That Changes Itself. It's really good. It's all about neuroplasticity. And there's a study that gets mentioned in that by Michael Merzenich, I think, and someone else whose name I can't remember. They stimulate the nucleus basalis with microelectrodes, and they manage to reopen critical periods for pitch recognition in adult rats, which is fascinating. Because it means, in theory, that you could relearn, you know, you could if you're a gymnast and you want to learn a tricky new routine, you could reopen your critical period and, you know, learn it in a flash. But, you know, it's very science fiction stuff, this.
I know you also touched on a bit of, you know, something I've talked a bit of a few times on the podcast about concussions. Can you tell us a little bit about, you know, what we found about that?
Yeah, so I went up to Glasgow, which is where one of the sort of leading brain experts in the world, really, both in the UK and the world, a guy called Dr. William Stewart is based, and he's got a lab and he's got thousands of samples of people with head trauma and athletes. There's an equivalent in Boston, the Boston Brain Bank, which is where a lot of NFL players, deceased NFL players, they kind of bequeath their brains to this lab for them to be studied. But I looked at some of the, they slice the brains so you can look at them under a microscope. And I saw some of the examples of, you know, former rugby players and footballers and looked at what CT actually looks like in the brain, which is fascinating. And it kind of looks like, so if a normal healthy brain looks like a marble floor, I think CT kind of looks like if you poured a glass of red wine on the floor and sort of let it soak in. It's amazing. So one of the things that Dr. Stewart is working on is kind of ways of detecting a concussion sooner, so that and also kind of working out when an athlete is safe to return to play. Because one of the most dangerous things is not just getting a concussion, but getting a concussion and then playing in the game the next week, or, you know, going back to training too soon. That's when you can kind of really make your symptoms more severe than they need to be. So one of the things that his lab has found is that there's a protein released by brain cells when they die. And you can actually detect this protein in blood tests. So one of the hardest things is to diagnose how severe a concussion has been, because you can't diagnose it by just looking at the video, because it depends on person to person. It depends on the sort of angle of the impact and the speed of the impact, and also so many factors. So there's no way of determining how severe a concussion has been from just watching the video, or even from the sort of cognitive tests that you do afterwards. But the severity of a concussion is determined by the amount of damage to nerve cells in the brain. So by doing a blood test for this protein, which is released when these neurons die, and measuring the level of this protein, it's called SNTF, I think, the protein, you can tell basically how severe the concussion was, and therefore you can get a more accurate measure of when an athlete is ready to return to play. And by doing that, you can prevent or help prevent some of the sort of more severe effects of CT that we've seen famously in the US and also in the UK with rugby players and NFL players. And in, of course, in that movie with Will Smith recently.
Yeah, no, I think that sounds like really important. I know that's one of the hardest things to decide, when to allow an athlete to go back on the field. And
yeah, it's also about making an informed decision as well, because I think we know now that these sports are risky, but what we don't know is how risky.
Mm-hmm.
And what one point that Dr. Stewart makes is, while playing rugby might increase your chances of, you know, getting Alzheimer's or dementia when you're older, playing a sport actually reduces your chances of getting heart disease or, you know, being obese or that kind of thing. So, you kind of got to weigh up the balances and do a risk assessment. But in order to do that, you need to know what the risk is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely. I think we don't want to scare people off activity. So I guess in the final part, one of the final things you do in the book is you talk about how you can apply some of these things we're doing in elite sport to kind of everyday lives of mere mortals like us. Can you talk a bit about that aspect?
Yeah, so there are all sorts of tips that might help you out. So that kind of comes from all over the book. But I think if you play a team sport, I think actually understanding the processes that you go through is a really big help. You know, if you play baseball, I think understanding that where you look is really important is something that kind of is a really kind of simple idea that can actually have a really big benefit. There's this idea called the quiet eye. If you put eye trackers on people, if you put eye trackers on the best athletes in the world, what you find is actually that while amateurs' eye movements are kind of quite jerky, they kind of move around all over the place, experts look longer in one place and then they move their eyes and they look longer in another place. They're steady and kind of quite secure in their eye movements.
Mm-hmm.
And actually the quiet eye says that if you just look longer at the target, you know, your brain knows what to do, but you just need to give it the visual information that it needs. So if you're playing pool or golf or basketball, shooting free throws, if you just look at the target for longer, and if you always look at the same place on the target, mm-hmm. you'll find that your performance improves. So that's one tip, which I thought was really interesting. And I kind of, you know, I'm not much of a golfer, but I went to play mini golf shortly after writing that section. And, you know, anecdotally, I did a lot better.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, no, I've had kind of mixed results applying my knowledge of the science too. But yeah, I think you're right. There are some very simple things people can do.
And then, of course, there's the whole choking under pressure thing, which you know all about, mm-hmm. and kind of the breakdown of automatic skills under distraction. But I think if you understand how that works, you can kind of, it kind of helps you fight it in a way.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I agree. I was just preparing a presentation right now to try to give people some tips about, you just have to know what can happen and kind of accept it. Yeah,
exactly.
So I guess the final question I have for you is, as we're doing this interview, the Olympics just ended a few days ago. So I'm assuming you watched some of it. And was there anything that you saw that kind of connected particularly strongly with the topics you covered in your book?
There was a few things. In fact, there was one really interesting example. There was a cycling race on the track, and a British athlete called Jason Kenny was competing in this. But there was basically two false starts.
Mm-hmm.
And basically what it meant was that instead of the race starting straight away, there was like a 20-minute delay, and they kind of had all that time to kind of overthink it and, you know, think about it. And it's really interesting how that can impact on your performance, you know, in a simple thing like delaying something by 10 minutes or, you know, icing the kicker or whatever, you know, just making them wait for longer than they'd like to can kind of really impact on people's performances, because they overthink it and, you know, this automatic process becomes amateurish again, they choke under pressure. But obviously now British cycling is, they're brilliant at it. And one of the reasons they're brilliant at it is because they've been applying all sorts of sports science techniques to it, from aerodynamics and nutrition right through to psychology and neuroscience. I guess it was a real vindication of those efforts when, you know, even after a 20-minute delay, this overwhelming favourite didn't succumb to the pressure and just absolutely stormed the race. And I guess while if you were just watching that, just kind of think, oh yeah, well, the best athlete won, but actually the processes underlying that victory and the kind of the mental side of it, I think is really fascinating. And there were loads of examples of that in the Olympics, the pressure and performance and making high speed decisions under immense pressure. And, you know, these athletes aren't just bundles of muscles. They don't just train their bodies, you know, in the 4-year cycle. They also train their brains. And I think that's something that I really tried to get across in the book.
Yeah, no, I agree. That's a good example. It is, Olympics is just fascinating, you know, 4 years of preparation for one competition, and then you don't, you know, so it's so much pressure. It's amazing how well they handle it. And when you're, like you say, when their routine gets thrown off. Well, that's all the questions I have for you. I just wanted to say I thoroughly enjoyed your book and I highly recommend it. So thanks for taking some time to talk with me.
Great. Thank you for having me, Rob.
Thanks again for the great discussion, Amit. I think your book does a great job considering the current state of play in this area and where things are headed. You can order The Athletic Brain and help this podcast at the same time by going to perceptionaction.com/recommended or by using the link in the show notes. Coming soon on the Perception in Action podcast, what kind of feedback do coaches give boxers between rounds, and how does it influence the outcome of the bout? This is Rob Gray from ASU. Cheers for now. If tears were liquor.